Well, good afternoon, everyone. This afternoon, we're here to celebrate the life of Everett Jude Freeman. At the start of the service, on behalf of the Freeman and Martin families, I'd just like to take a moment to welcome each one of you here, to thank you for coming. For the many also who are perhaps watching online who couldn't be here today, but you're joining in that way, we want to thank you for taking the time to be part of this service today. I'd also like to thank Bayside Family Church for hosting the service here in their church, for the love and support of so many, for the love and support of immediate family, for church family, and the wider community that's made today possible. My name's Godfrey Wilkinson. I'm the pastor of Harvest Church here in town, and I have the honor and the privilege to be conducting this celebration of life for Everett. Why don't we open up our time in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we come before you today. And Lord, we approach your throne. And Lord, thank you that you promise us in your word that as we approach, Lord, that we can find grace and mercy to help us in our time of need. God, thank you that you promise us that you are a comfort, that you are a rock, that you are a shelter, that you are a refuge, an ever-present help in times of trouble. Lord, thank you that you are our shepherd. Jesus, that you said that greater love has no man than this than to lay his life down for his friends. And so, God, I thank you that as we come here today in the hardest of circumstances, in the most tragic of times, with grief and sorrow and broken hearts, Lord, I thank you that we can come into your presence and find comfort. I thank you that we can find a peace when we truly rely on you, a peace that surpasses all understanding, and that you promise us that you will supply our every need. And so, Lord, we take a moment to turn to you now and to acknowledge that. And Lord, as we celebrate the life of Everett and the beautiful gift that you gave and the beautiful gift that you've received onto yourself again, Lord, we want to make this service, as we celebrate his life, Lord, we want to make this service a service that is glorifying and honoring and pleasing to you. And so, Lord, I pray that you would be with all of us, Lord. Strengthen us and equip us and comfort the family who are here today as we come before you now. And we pray this in your name. Amen. Amen. I want to open the service by reading from Psalm 147. We're going to have a time of worship together this afternoon. In Psalm 147, the psalmist writes, and the title of the psalm is this, it says, "He heals the brokenhearted." And the psalmist says this, "Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant, and a song of praise is fitting." As we come brokenhearted and heavy-hearted today, the Lord invites us to do this. He says it's fitting, and it's pleasing, and it's right, and this is how we'll find our comfort and our hope, that we can come and worship him. It says it's fitting. It goes on, it says this, "The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of the stars. He gives to all of them their names. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The Lord lifts up the humble. He casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre. He covers the heavens with clouds. He prepares rain for the earth. He makes grass grow on the hills. He gives to the beasts their food and to the young ravens that cry. His delight is not in the strength of the horse, nor his pleasure in the legs of a man. But the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love." We have a hope today. And the family has a hope today, and our hope is the steadfast love of the Lord. And so we're going to invite you to stand together as we worship and as we sing of the hope that we have in God right now. So let's do that. Let's stand and let's worship.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest trial and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, and up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ we stand.
Amen. Take your seats.
At this time, we're going to have our second scripture reading from 1 Peter that continues to talk about the hope that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to invite John Boyes, who serves as an elder for us at Harvest Church, and he's going to come and bring that scripture reading to us now. Thank you, John.
His great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls.
Let's stand one more time.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven. Spoke your name, into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. Work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages, from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross is spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Sing hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me.
Let's proclaim that again together.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Sing hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope.
Amen. Jesus Christ is our living hope. And that is the reason why we can grieve and we can celebrate the life of Everett today. Everett was a beautiful gift from the Lord and a beautiful boy who was cherished and loved and cared for by his family dearly. And we're going to hear that now as I'm going to invite some of the family forward as they take time to share some beautiful tributes to Everett. We're going to hear from Alicia, who is Everett's aunt. We're going to hear from Kirby as an uncle. And lastly, we're going to hear from Corey, father of Everett. So we're going to invite you to do that now. Alicia, if you want to come forward.
Everett, you were so loved and will be missed so much by your cousins, your aunts, and your uncles. Both your younger and older cousins enjoyed spending time with you, and your gentle spirit made you easy for everyone to love and get along with. Oftentimes, you would go back and forth between hanging out with your older cousins and playing with your younger cousins. They all wanted your attention and affection. You were always up for board or card games, but also enjoyed playing hockey or baseball or laser tag. Akeisha's favorite memory of you is playing hockey together at Christmas. She didn't often get one-to-one time with you, but that day you both played hockey for hours together. You were so happy playing the game that you love. Alexa will miss being your hero, though she did notice that you didn't follow her around quite as much as you used to. It will be so different without you there to be a bridge between the big kids and the little kids with her. So many memories were made over the past 9 years. But on our last night of camping, you had us all in stitches around the fire, putting popcorn in your ears, licking Alexa's dirty feet, and being so silly. You were so shy as a little boy, but the last couple of years, you really came out of your shell and gained confidence, and we were starting to see your funny side. Quentin and Rylan will miss you so, so much. They love playing soccer and basketball with you, tenting together at our Martin campouts, and having pogo stick competitions going into the thousands. You were a quiet but determined competitor and always such a good sport. Your laugh made us feel like laughing along with you. It's not going to be the same without you around. Cody is so thankful for the special memories he got to make with you these past few weeks. He was so excited about having you closer to him and spending more time together. His favorite memory is tackling each other in the yard playing football while Corey played the goofy referee. He loved watching how you would laugh at your dad's silly antics and teasing. Cody also remembers you helping him put together his Lego kit at Christmas time. Orion and Carter have always adored you and looked up to you. You spent hours playing board games, card games, and any other type of game with Orion. You insisted on always playing by the rules and never let anyone get away with being sneaky. No matter how many meltdowns ensued, you were always ready to try again and stay calm and patient. The last time I saw you before you went on your big adventure on Friday, you were playing in the hammock with Carter, making him laugh and shriek as you tickled and wrestled him. He will miss you like crazy. Your little girl cousins don't have many memories of you other than watching you play with your siblings, but even Juniper adored you. I love the way you grinned at me with a delighted and amused expression as she followed you around the other day, saying, "What you want to do, Everett? What you want to do?" You leave such a big, big hole in our family. We're dreading the first Christmas, first campouts, first birthday parties without you there. But we're looking forward to seeing you again someday in heaven. We know you are perfectly safe and perfectly loved. Thank you for being ours for 9 years.
I'm reading this for my sister, Amy, who wrote this for Everett. Everett Jude Freeman, or as we like to call you, EJ. You were an awesome kid. Everett, one of the most recent memories of you is sitting around the campfire at your new house in Parry Sound. One of the kids found an old corded phone and you stood behind your dad while he convinced Orion that this unplugged phone works. As you told Orion your dad's phone number, he punched them in. You giggled as your dad's phone rang because you knew that Kirby was calling your dad, not the old phone. Everett loved to be involved in these jokes that most of the kids would have missed, but he sometimes had the inside track with the adults. He knew what was going on. Everett, even though you've known us from the day you entered the world, you still sometimes were a little stubborn and would stare blankly at us when we asked a question. However, as soon as we would sit beside you on the couch to watch a hockey game, you became a chatterbox. The amount of stats you kept in that brain will forever amaze us. You were the kind of child who would write out the Roman numerals just because you could. You took a calculator to bed so you could do equations before you fell asleep. Your mathematical brain was multiplying and dividing while most kids your age were still struggling to figure out adding and subtracting. Piper and Sage were blessed with the greatest big brother they could have. They both loved and adored you. Everett, you left us too early, but we will forever be grateful for all the memories we made in the 9 years we had with you.
When Everett was born to me and my wife Amberly, in our wildest dreams, we had no idea what was in store for us. We named him Everett because it means brave as a wild boar. What we got was the sweetest, smartest, tamest wild boar you could imagine. Everett started sleeping through the night at 7 weeks old and never looked back. He was so sweet, so clever, so cautious, so logical. In his 9 years, he probably only needed a Band-Aid less than 5 times. He was too smart and careful for Band-Aids. His mind was a work of art. He soaked up information. He just loved learning about the world. To Everett, numbers were toys to be played with. He memorized more Thomas the Train names than I would have guessed even existed. He slaughtered us at a parent's least favorite game, memory, again and again. His level of comprehension continually astounded us. Over and over, we would ask him how he knew something we didn't expect him to know. And he would just humbly shrug and give every boy's favorite answer, "I don't know." He loved playing games and was soon learning adult board games. I'm pretty sure that he could wrap his head around a new game faster than I could. Things just made sense to Everett. He even taught himself to play some new adult board games just by reading the rules himself. And he was great at explaining the rules to his sister Piper in a way that she could understand as well. Piper is going to miss all those games that you were beginning to play together. You latched on to the Rubik's Cube, and we loved watching your fingers fly as you twisted it around at breakneck speed, flying through the algorithm to solve it as fast as you could. Spelling also came naturally to you, and you recently became hooked on the fad game Wordle, along with your parents. You still couldn't quite say your R's properly, but I would love to hear you ask again, "Daddy, can I play Wordle?" You were so good at Wordle. Somehow, despite the fact that you often hadn't even heard of the word before, you were almost always able to solve them, and often in less guesses than it took me. It had reached a point where if after his 6 guesses he still hadn't solved it, I would celebrate openly and loudly, because it was so rarely that he'd be beaten. Early on in his life, Everett showed no interest in sports. Eventually, a switch went off and he became obsessed. Watching and playing sports together is one of the things I'm going to miss most. We got to spend so much time hanging out in this way. He wasn't the most athletically gifted, so his dream of playing for the Toronto Maple Leafs wasn't likely to materialize. This dream was also not aided by the fact that his indoor hockey play often involved just a stick and his imagination. A pucker ball just got in the way. However, he might have had a future as a sports broadcaster. When he got excited, he could talk a blue streak. He would constantly drown out the broadcast announcers with his incessant observations and commentary on the games. He had so many players' number memorized. He loved the stats of the game, so many numbers. Sports, numbers, and chattering were 3 of his favorite things. So needless to say, when there was a hockey game on, Everett was a dangerous man. So many times I would ask him to tone it down so I could hear better. But he couldn't contain himself for long, and he was loudly and excitedly talking again. If I could watch one more game with him, I think I might just put the TV on mute. Everett, just last week you started clearing out trails in the bush behind our house. I came home from work and was so proud of the work you had accomplished in just one day. You and Piper only got to enjoy one day of biking on those beautiful trails together. We are so proud of you, Everett. But even more than your incredible talents, we are so proud of the person you were. You were such a great big brother. You were so proud of Piper and Sage. You loved them with everything you had, and they loved you back equally. Your heart was even bigger than your mind. I love that even at 9 years old, you would occasionally let your sister hold your hand as you were playing or walking with her. The two of you were so opposite in so many ways, but you stuck together like glue on glue. You share a bond that even death cannot break. When we moved up north, you and your toddler brother got to sleep in the same bed. You would quietly and proudly grin at us as Sage rambled on in his bedtime prayers, repeating things over and over or thanking God for things that grown-ups think are silly. Sage was so excited to finally be in a big boy bed with his hero. Sage would chatter and flail around as you tried to read your book, and you quietly put up with it. Even when Sage kept you up late or woke you up in the middle of the night or morning, you didn't complain. You just commented that you were looking forward to Sage getting his own bed. You were a hero to your cousins, and they latched on to you. They soaked up your attention like sponges. You were such a loving friend to those that spent enough time with you to crack your shy shell. You were finally starting to learn to stand up for yourself, but you were still so patient and tolerant, even when you knew your playmates were taking advantage of you. You had such a great sense of humor and seldom failed to catch a joke. You were just starting to love making people laugh by being a goof. You were a delight, and we will continue to delight in our countless memories of you. I haven't just lost a son. I've lost a best friend. Friend that was okay with me giving him lots of kisses on the top of his head. We were two peas in a pod. Everett, I'm so grateful that of all the families God could have placed you in, he chose me and Mommy's home. You were a perfect fit. Better than we could have ever imagined. You were such a blessing. You brought us so much joy. So much laughter, so much delight. You were a gift. You have forever marked our hearts and our lives, and we will continue to celebrate and remember you. You will always be in our hearts. My daughter Piper summed it up best when asked what she liked to do the most with Everett. Her answer was everything. Thank you to our siblings, nieces and nephews, parents and grandparents for loving Everett so well. He loved you. To everyone hearing my voice, words fail me to sufficiently thank you. Thank you for how you've been here for my family for the last 7 days. Thank you to the countless men and women and boys and girls who prayed for Everett's safety and who desperately tried to help us bring Everett back home safely. God has surrounded us with such an incredible community of friends and strangers who have been loving us so well. Your compassion, your love, your prayers, and your selfless generosity are helping us face each new moment knowing that we are loved and that we will never have to walk this journey alone. I believe that we have received a small taste of the perfect love that Everett is now dwelling with in heaven. It is truly unlike anything we have ever known before. We praise God for Everett and for his steadfast love towards us and for the unshakable hope we can cling to. This past year as a family, we memorized Psalm 23 together. Not surprisingly, Everett was able to memorize scripture very quickly, and he was able to recite them out loud very quickly. However, we had no idea that so quickly we would enter that dark valley and that Everett was about to be called to his forever home with Jesus. This is God's promise to us that we memorize together. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths, bring honor to his name. Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You honor me by anointing my head with oil. My cup overflows with blessings. Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever. Everett, I love you. Mommy, Piper, and Sage love you. We love you. Best of all, Jesus loves you. Enjoy the house of the Lord. We will see you soon.
Try to hold on to this world with everything I have, but I feel the weight of what it brings and the hurt that tries to grab. The many trials that seem to never end. His word declares this truth that we will enter in this rest with wonders anew. But I hold on to this hope, promise that he brings, that there will be a place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, and no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. But until that day, we'll hold on to you. All alone, troubled soul, don't lose your heart.
Thank you to all of the family for giving us and sharing with us a smaller glimpse of the beautiful gift that was Everett. I'm thankful that the message that I'm going to share with you is a reiteration of what we've already heard so wonderfully proclaimed by them. The real question that so many people ask when such tragedy comes and when such heartache enters our world, the question that so many people ask is, where do we turn in a time like this? To a family, to a father, to a mother, to a sister, to a brother, to grandparents, to uncles and aunts, to cousins, extended family, friends, and everyone else who so dearly loves Everett, what is there to say? What comfort can be given? What hope can be offered? What peace can be found? The truth is that in and of myself, and in and of the people around you here gathered today, that everyone who is here, your friends, your family, none of us can offer the hope that you need. The physical things of this life offer no hope in death. Even the most beautiful ceremony and flowers and pictures and tributes cannot offer you the hope that you need, even though those things are perfect and fitting and right for this occasion. An overwhelmingly loving community cannot offer you the hope that you need. And the reason that is that in death, all of us are powerless and incapable to fix what has happened. None of us, no one here today, as much as we would love you to, can reunite you with this beautiful boy, Everett. And I can guarantee that there's nothing in this world that the Freeman family wouldn't happily give away or do without to be able to embrace Everett again. And so with death before us today, it's fair to say and real to say that in and of ourselves, this whole situation would seem hopeless. If we're relying on our own strength and our own ability, or the capacity and ability of other people even to love us well, then the grief is going to be never-ending. Death is final and irreversible, and all of us with our lives that we realize in times like this are so fragile are just left to move on and to bear the pain. Now, you might say that's a really strange and terrible way to speak this afternoon, but I make that point to say this. I'm thankful and I'm honored that I get to speak and share a message with you today at this service, but I'm ultimately thankful that I'm not up here today to try and give you, family and friends and loved ones, some words of comfort or hope that I have mustered up by myself, because at the end of the day, I know that that would really be of no value to you. And if left to me, I would feel so woefully inadequate to ever stand up here and say anything. But today I am thankful that in times like these, we can turn to God. And it's there we can find comfort and rest and hope. I'm going to read a passage with you from God's Word, His revelation to us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And the book of 1 Thessalonians, it's a book that's in God's Word, that's in the Bible, and it's called that because it is Paul, the Apostle Paul's first letter to the church in Thessalonica. It's a place that exists today. It's in modern-day Greece. And Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, by God himself, writes a letter to the church in Greece because they were living in a place and in a time where the people around them didn't believe in God. The outlooks of the people that lived in that time was just life is precious and short, but that's it. And so how they lived was they lived for themselves. They enjoyed life to the max. They made the most of family. They lived like there's no tomorrow, perhaps even partied hard, because when the end comes for them, they believe that's it. It's done. The world around the church had no hope after death. In fact, archaeologists discovered time and time again that a very typical inscription on a gravestone for the Greeks in that time read this. They've uncovered them time and time again. A typical headstone would read this: I was not, I became, I am not, I care not. That was their outlook on life. At one time there was nothing. They became something. There came a time when they were no more. And so they didn't have to care about anything. See, without God, without the promise of eternal life, without believing in Jesus Christ, God's revelation and accomplishment through him, death is the ultimate picture of hopelessness. But you may have noticed the songs that we've already sang and the beautiful tributes that were shared are filled with hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope, and Christ alone, my hope is found, because God's word today has a different message for us than hopelessness. It has a different message than saying Everett missed the best years of his life. It has a different message than saying that death has robbed this family of him. In fact, God loves us so much that he brings perfect clarity for what death means to those of us who believe in Jesus Christ. While it could be easy to sit in hopelessness and despair and feeling like there is no way to live tomorrow, let alone the rest of our lives without Everett, I want you to listen to the words of God this afternoon. 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 13 to 18 says this: But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. This is God's word to us this afternoon. You see, in a time where it could be easy to embrace the narrative of hopelessness and despair, God tells us something else. God comes in right now and says, I don't want you to be uninformed. There is hope. The reality is death is not the final step. So therefore, he says, so be encouraged. I love how God describes those who we would say have died. God's word says those who die have only fallen asleep. You know what happens to people when they're sleeping? They wake up, don't they? It's not the final step for them. In fact, in our 24-hour day, we are so blessed and consider it a wonderful accomplishment if we achieved 8 hours sleep without somebody jumping on us or kids prodding us or something else coming in to wake us up. We would consider ourselves blessed. And so verse 13, Paul reminds us as believers whose faith is in Jesus Christ, he says, listen, don't be uninformed about those who are asleep. Why? So that you can grieve differently. You can grieve differently than those who have no hope. Beautiful thing is, as Christians, as Christ followers, we know that death is not the end. God is saying, have this perspective, remember this reality amidst all the confusion and wrestling and unanswered questions of the here and now. Death is only temporary. And in the scale of eternity of our lives, the Bible says our life now is like a vapor in the wind. It's like a flower that opens for a season and fades. And so the hope is that God's word actually tells us to keep this perspective. Why? So that we can grieve differently now. That we can grieve differently because we do in fact have hope. A hope that death is not final, and a hope that one day we will see Everett again. And what is the source of this hope? I love that we have to be clear, when the Bible talks about hope, we talk about the idea of like, well, I hope it doesn't rain tomorrow. It could be like a 50-50 chance. We don't know. When the Bible talks about hope, it's biblical certainty, absolute truth. It's going to happen. And here's the hope that we have. Here's why we can have this hope. Verse 14 says this, "For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep." The hope we have is that death is not the final step, because life is offered to us through Jesus Christ, because he died and rose again, through what God has accomplished for us, because of the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Just as he was resurrected, there will one day be a resurrection for those of us who believe in him. For those of us who are innocent as children before God, and for those of us who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, death is not final, but one day we will be resurrected with him. There's a portion in Scripture, Romans chapter 6, verses 3 to 5, it says this. It says, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?" What that's talking about is baptism is this beautiful command from the Lord that we're given as followers, that as we give our lives to Christ, as we confess our sin and our need of Jesus as a Savior, that the Bible says that he commands us to be baptized. And in the act of baptism, what happens is the person is put under the water and they're brought back up, and it symbolizes that we're dying to our old way of life and we're a new creation in Christ. And so this passage here in Romans 6, it says, "We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life." It says this, "If we've been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his." This is what Jesus Christ has accomplished for us. That whenever we die to ourselves and associate with Christ's death, that just as Jesus Christ was raised to life, we too have this hope. The gospel of Jesus Christ is that God offers to us new life, and that is attained through the life of his perfect son, through his death and resurrection. And how was all of this accomplished? How was Jesus raised from the dead? Well, it says it in that passage. It says it's by the glory of the Father. God is pleased to offer us eternal life. God is pleased to offer Everett eternal life and to receive him, because God will be glorified. God will be glorified in the resurrection of our bodies that have failed in death, to be perfect with him, all for his glory. You know what the incredible part of all of this is how God always intended it to be. This is how God plans to restore his creation to what he first made it. If you read the Bible, which is God's word to us, you get to Genesis 1, and it begins by saying that God spoke. God made, God created this world. He spoke us into existence. Isn't that the awesome, incredible power of God, that God speaks and things are made and created? And it talks about how God created this world and the sun and the moon and the stars and all the animals. And in each day and each day of the account, it says that at the end of the day, God saw that it was good. And as God created each day, he would look down and he would see that his creation was perfectly good. And then when you get to day 6, and God makes man and woman, and he says it said that he looked down and said, "Let us make man in our own image." And so he breathed life into us. What sets us apart from animals and everything else in creation is that God gave us an eternal soul. And it says that God saw that it was very good. And Psalm 19:1 tells us this. It says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork." It's saying God's creation, God's handiwork, God's artwork was made to declare to us his glory, to reveal how incredible and how awesome God is. And so Everett, made and created by God, his days ordained and numbered by God, Everett was and is a beautiful piece of art, a beautiful work from God, beautiful creation from the Creator. Everett is God's handiwork. And the uniqueness and the beauty and the genius of Everett that we heard testified to today is just one way in which God reveals to his family the beauty of himself. God's creation is a reflection of God's glory, his goodness, and in the Garden of Eden, and Adam and Eve, it says, perfectly dwelled with God, and at that time there was no pain, there was no sickness, there was no sadness, there was no death. It was just God's perfect glory, and there was perfect joy, perfect peace, perfect rest, all because of God's glory. But what happens? You get to Genesis 3, and sin entered the world. Adam and Eve chose to live for themselves. They decided not to live for God's glory, but said, we want to decide what's good and evil. We want our own glory. We'll live for ourselves. And because of that, they had to be cast out of the perfect presence of God. Sin corrupted what was perfect. It's a result of sin that brought death and separation from God. And Romans 3:23 tells us that all of us have sinned and all of us fall short of this perfect standard, this perfect glory of God. None of us perfectly reflect God in all of his goodness. Romans 6:23 tells us that the wages of our sin, the earnings of our sin, is actually death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The reality is all of us deserve death to be the final ending place for us. All of us deserve the punishment of death, which is eternal separation from God. For all of us, we deserve death to be hopeless. But God in his glory did something incredible. One of the most well-known verses of Scripture is John 3:16, and it tells us this, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." And this is what Jesus Christ accomplished for us. Jesus Christ lived a perfect life, a holy life, a life that perfectly displayed the glory of God, that radiated the glory of God the Father, and he did not deserve death. He did not deserve the punishment of God. And that is why, though, that Jesus was the only person, the only man to ever live and walk in the flesh on this earth that is able to offer himself up as a sacrifice for our sin. He was the only person who ever could. And by dying on the cross, he took the penalty and punishment for our sin. And by rising again, the Bible says he's seated at the right hand of God the Father, and he's there. He's interceding for us. He's representing us. So that if we believe in him, if we confess our need of a Savior, Jesus Christ, that God has given and provided for us, we too can have this incredible hope. That death is not to be feared, and death is not hopeless, but is merely a falling asleep as we go to be with the presence of the Lord. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians that God made him who knew no sin to become sin for us. Why? So that we could receive, or we could inherit, the righteousness of God. We could be made right with God. We could be born again. We could be seen as holy before God, so holy that God's Holy Spirit is pleased to dwell within us as we give our lives to Christ. And Jesus, when he was on this earth, spoke of the reality of these things. In John 14, the command of Jesus was this to his followers. He said, "Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." Jesus spoke those words before he ascended into heaven. And so today we know that the Bible also tells us that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. It says we can be of good courage. We can have hope today. This is not a hopeless situation. It is right and it is fitting to grieve, but it's right to celebrate. Not only the earthly life that Everett lived and blessed us with in so many ways, but it's right to celebrate that as his soul is absent from the body, that he is perfectly in the presence of the Lord. I love how the family have talked of Everett and spoken of his adventure the adventure that he was on and the incredible adventure that he now has reached in heaven. One of the most beautiful things and encouragement for me is I walked into the lobby of this church and there was beautiful decorations to just give us a little glimpse of whoever it was and what was special to him and what was important to him. The very first thing that I seen as I walked into the church and I came over to the first table was this. Everett's Adventure Bible. And I love that it is worn and tattered and it is well used. And Everett's handwriting is inside it. And as Corey shared, that they were raising him up and teaching him about the love of God and the goodness of God and how incredible God is and the reason for why we live, to honor him and worship him and reflect his glory. And Everett was on the adventure of his life, understanding and coming to comprehend who God is. But now Everett is in the perfect presence of the Lord. And he is able to understand and know and experience the perfect love of the Father in ways that we cannot comprehend here, but in ways in which we get to look forward to. As many people searched and wondered and prayed for Everett, he was not in distress. He was not lost. He was not worried. He was perfectly in the arms of Jesus. So our hope today is that Everett's soul is in paradise. This is what happens to those of us who believe in Jesus. But not only that, this passage that we read, the hope that we have is that Jesus is returning. One day Christ will return, and what will happen? Verses 16 and 17 said this, "The Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive when Christ returns, it says, or who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we'll always be with him. When that happens, the earth will be judged. Those who don't believe in Christ will be separated from the goodness and joy and peace of God, instead receive the just and right eternal punishment for sin. And when God has judged the earth, both the living and the dead, and wiped out sin once and for all, the promise that we have is that God will make the new heavens and the new earth. That the Garden of Eden that you read about in Genesis at the start will ultimately be restored. That's really what eternity is, what heaven will be. It's Eden restored, the perfect place of God dwelling with us. And our souls will be given new bodies. Revelation 21, at the very end of the Bible, it says this, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.'" So what does that mean for you today, Corey? For you today, Amberly? For you, Piper? And for Sage? And for all the family who believe in Jesus Christ? It means that the reality and the certainty is this, that one day, you will walk with Everett again. That one day you will laugh with him again. That you will sing and dance and play with him again. That you will be restored with him again in the new heavens and the new earth when your faith is in Jesus Christ. And all of this is done to show and to reveal just how awesome and how wonderful God is. And this is how God will be glorified. Because God is all for his glory. And the implications of that are huge, because that means something if God is for his glory, if that is God's goal to reveal himself, because it means this. It means that the real pain and the heartache and the grief and the tears today, all of the things that we want to wrestle with and say why and how, and I wouldn't have done it this way, God, how could you get glory in this? All of the real pain and grief today that's right to have, will one day be so far outweighed by the incredible glory that God will have in reuniting you with your son in eternity. And that means that today the pain and the tears and the heartache and the sorrow and the lives that we will continue to live missing Everett are not meaningless, and they're not without purpose. See, all of this causes us to shift our perspective from the temporary to the eternal and live our lives with this focus. I believe God has and will continue to use the life of Everett and all who follow Jesus to draw more people to the life-saving news of the gospel that offers us eternal hope. There is a hope and a saving grace from God that we cannot earn. We cannot find favor with God by ourselves, but it's freely given to us through Jesus Christ if we believe in him, if we repent of our own ways and our own sinful life and we follow him. One of my favorite passages of scripture is found in Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. It says this, it says, "For by grace you've been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing, it's the gift of God. It's not a result of works, so that no one may boast." That is the good news of the gospel and the hope that is freely offered to each and every one of us. We will never live a life that's perfect. We will never live a life that perfectly reflects the glory of God. We will all fall short of his standards, no matter how good and how great we try to live, and even how faithfully we try to grieve. But it's not dependent on us, and it's not dependent on our works. It's freely offered to us if our faith is in Jesus Christ. And here's what I love about that passage. It goes on to say this: "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." God's word declares again to us, it says, we are his workmanship. Now, sometimes we look at people and we might be tempted to say, or we say inwardly, they're a piece of work. Tone is everything. But God looks at all of us and says, listen, you're a piece of work. You're a piece of art. We're God's handiwork. We're his workmanship. And we were created in Christ Jesus to walk in good works which God prepared for us beforehand. Look, God had prepared Everett's life and all the days of his life beforehand. Psalm 139, 16 says this, "Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them." And I hope that you as a family can find comfort in knowing that. That God created us, that he knows all of us, that he knew Everett. He saw our unformed substance. He knew us before we were born. He knew all of the days that he had formed us for and made us for before we'd even lived them. And that means that we don't have to live today in the what ifs, because God's plan is perfect. As a family, you don't have to live wondering, what if we had done this? Or what if we had changed our plans? Or what if we hadn't moved to Perry Sound? And all of those what ifs. God, as the artist, chose to receive Everett back to himself after 9 years. And we'll never understand all of the whys. But the ultimate purpose of that work is to point us not to the temporary, but to the eternal hope that is found in the eternal reality of the home that we have in heaven, where Everett already is today. That's why we can sing in our service from life's first cry to final breath that Jesus commands our destiny. God's perfect plan for Everett's life was to reveal his goodness, his love, his awesomeness through this beautiful boy for 9 years. His days were chosen and orchestrated by God. And so today we celebrate what God gave in Everett. And because he was so loved and cherished and unique and beautiful, we grieve that for now he is absent from us. But that grief is not for Everett, because he is with the Lord. The pain and the tears and the hugs and the words of comfort today, they are not for Everett. They're for us, because we miss the beautiful gift that the Lord blessed us with. In Philippians 1, it says, For us to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Paul in Philippians actually wrestles, and he says, what should I choose, or what could I do if I was given a choice? He said, I'd be so hard-pressed to choose between the two, because my desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better, and that is wherever it is today. And so, yes, we grieve, and tomorrow we will grieve, and for the rest of our lives, we will grieve, and we can grieve in a different way, in a God-honoring way, in a way that reveals the hope that we have, that death is not final. But as we experience sin and brokenness and heartache here, it is a light, momentary affliction, only when it's compared to the surpassing glory that will be revealed to us in heaven. I love that that is the inheritance that's waiting for us. That our inheritance that's waiting for us, listen, the inheritance that's waiting for us, that God has prepared for us, it's not Everett. It's not just Everett. That Everett will be a part of that, a part of the incredible inheritance that God has promised to us, that living hope that is spoken about in Peter, that there's this beautiful inheritance that's unfading, that's imperishable, that's undefiled, that's kept in heaven for us. And so today, and in the days and months and years ahead, we can grieve differently than those without hope. It's in times like this when we would so often say that perhaps life has hit rock bottom. It's only in times like this that you really find out what that rock is. And it is so abundantly clear that the rock on which the Freeman family is standing upon is Jesus Christ. And that is the best place for which you can stand. And that is not a hope that is a wishy-washy maybe hope. It is a certain hope, and it is a hope that will not be put to shame. I close with this. Romans 5 says this, not only that, but we can rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. That is why the passage of scripture that we read in 1 Thessalonians 4 says, therefore, because of this, because of the reality and the hope that we have, we can encourage one another with these words. And so today we trust and we know that Everett is safe, that Everett is part of God's perfect plan, that Everett's life is a life well lived and a life that will continue to bring great glory to God as we continue to miss him, to share memories of him, to grieve him, but also to share the faith and the hope that one day we will see him again. Everett, you have been loved and cherished and enjoyed on this earth by so many, but now we know you're experiencing perfect love with your Father in heaven. And for all of us, we look forward to the day when the Lord returns or calls us home. And through Jesus Christ, by God's grace and mercy, we will see you again. And we look forward to that day. Let us pray and thank God for the hope that we have. Heavenly Father, you tell us in your word that every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. That it comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Father, thank you for the gift of Everett. We thank you for how you created him, made him. We thank you for the gift he has been to his family, to his friends, to his community. And we thank you that even though we rightly weep and grieve for the changing of our circumstances here, we know, God, that in you, you are our rock, our refuge, our strength. You are unchanging with no variation. You are loving and good, and we can trust in you. Lord, we thank you that even as a family mourns the loss of a son, that we are reminded that you yourself lovingly did not spare your own son. But Jesus, you offered yourself up on the cross for us. And so, Lord, I pray that for the family, friends, and those of us here today and those who will hear of Everett, his life will continue to be a beautiful glimpse and reminder that leads us to the reality of how much you love us and the hope that we have in you. Thank you that Everett is with you today. Amen. Heaven is going to be awesome and wonderful and a day of great rejoicing. And today now, as we celebrate wherever it is, we're going to sing a worship song in anticipation of that day. This is a song that Everett's parents requested we sing as we worship together. And so that's what we're going to do right now. Why don't you stand with us, and we're going to sing of that day.
One day you'll make everything new, Jesus. One day you'll bind every wound. The former things shall all pass away, no more tears. One day you'll make sense of it all, Jesus, one day every question resolved. Every anxious thought left behind, no more fear.
Sing this together.
When we all get to heaven, what a wonderful day that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. One day we will see face to face Jesus. Is there a greater vision of grace? And in a moment we shall be changed on that day. And one day we'll be free, free indeed, Jesus. One day struggle will cease. And we will see your glory revealed on that day. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Lift it up. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. We'll sing and shout the victory.
I hope that's a true reality for all of us today. A few quick announcements as we continue on with our day celebrating Everett and laying him to rest. We're now going to proceed to Foley Cemetery for the interment. So anyone who wishes to join us at the graveside is welcome to do that. The family would love to have you there. If you would like to do that, you can feel free to follow the lead car as we proceed to do that now with the family. We'll wait here for the bearers to come and proceed first now before we exit today. There is a reception here. So the reception is now also, if you prefer to wait here, if you don't want us to join us at Foley, you can wait here. The reception will be downstairs, and the family, along with anyone else who would like to join us for the interment, will be returning here shortly. So right now I'll ask for the bearers to come forward. and we will wait here. Thank you for joining us with our service today.